Hello, welcome to this lecture. So in this lecture, we will get introduced with the new construction material, which is the timber. And also we will discuss briefly about the bamboo. So in this lecture, our main emphasis will be on the timber because we will be designing timber structures in the later lecture. So this is the content that we are going to discuss in this lecture. So now introducing the timber. So timber is basically a wood, and this wood is used by humans from many centuries for constructing houses, constructing bridges, and various types of structures. So now what is the difference between timber and wood? Well, basically the wood which is suitable to use in the engineering constructions or for various engineering purposes, then that wood is known as timber. So the wood which we are using in construction as a structure material will be known as the timber. We generally use nowadays various other construction material like the steel and concrete. And steel and concrete are of superior quality when we compare with the quality of timber, but still nowadays we use timber as a construction material. And like the steel and concrete, timber is not of consistent structural properties, and therefore timber is highly anisotropic material, which means it does not behave equally in all the direction. So timber is highly anisotropic material. Now, if we talk about the uses of timber, where can we use this timber? Well, timber is mostly used in the constructions and in some other areas also, but here we will be focused only on the construction. So in construction, timber is used in various forms. For example, timber as a structure member can be used as a column, it can be used as a beam, it can be used as a floor beam or floors, and as a truss member also, we can use timber. So here in these photos, you can see these horizontal members are basically the beams, and these vertical members are basically the column. Similarly, it is used in the trusses. Here also it is used in the trusses. So there are uses of timber in the construction. Similarly, timber can also be used in the scaffoldings and formworks. So when we construct homes, so we also use scaffolding to support the labor for working or for building the construction building, for constructing buildings. So here you can see for constructing concrete elements, we use these formworks so that the elements take a proper shape. So yes, timber can be used as a formwork also. Timber can be used in as a partition wall also. So when we have a space and we want to segregate that space, we can use partition wall in the form of timber also. So here you can see these are the partition walls which are used to segregate spaces. And doors and windows. So we see in the buildings, mostly we use windows and doors of timber. And timber is also used in the furnitures. So therefore, there are various uses of the timber. So now talking about the, if we want to understand the timber, first we will try to understand the cross-section of a tree trunk. We will see what is its appearance, what is its physical appearance, and what is the function of that. So here in this photo, you can see the three-dimensional view of a tree trunk. And there are various terms which are associated with these this cross section. So here we have the outside layer is basically known as the skin of the trunk, which is also known as the bark. And inside the bark, we have this portion which is called the live portion, and also it is known as the sap wood. Similarly, in the center, we have this part, which is called the heartwood. Now, in the heartwood, mostly the tissues of the timber are dead. So only in the sapwood, there are live tissues. So Now, beside this, you can see there are some small rays which are actually known as the medullary rays. So basically, timber, I mean, this trunk takes water from the roots and it transport the water to the trunk, to other branches, to the leaves. So this sapwood, as I said, these are the live tissues. Their role is to transfer the food to other members also. Like in the heartwood, these are the dead tissues. So this is basically the hardest part of the trunk. And in this central region, this is actually known as the pith. This is actually known as the pith. And pith is the hardest part of the trunk. And in other way, you can also consider this as the bone of the timber. So as I said, the wood of a tree trunk is mostly a dead tissue. The darker region is called the heartwood. The lighter, younger region of wood closer to the cambium is called the sapwood. So most of the moisture in the trunk is carried in this region, which is the sapwood. So this is the structure of the tree trunk. Now we will try to understand the microstructure of the wood also. So if we look at the microstructure, the timber, the cells of the timber are basically of tubular form. They are basically of the tubular form, carrying the moisture, and they are running along the long axis or running along the direction of the trunk. So here you can see this is the microscopic view of the timber structure. And here you can see these are the pipe-like structures. These are basically the tube-like structure actually. And these are filled with the moisture. So here you can see this fiber or cells, they are basically of tubular type of structures. And these tubular forms are attached together. Like you can see here, these are attached together with a sticky material, which is called the lignin. This is not very strong, but still they are attached with this sticky material. And the direction of this fiber, as you can see, the direction of this fiber is running along the length of the stem, or the trunk. And this direction is actually known as direction of the grain. And this direction of grain is very important for us when we consider the strength of the timber. So basically the strength of this wood will be higher along the length of the grain. And if the strength across the grain will be lower. We will try to understand this with more visuals in the next slide. So if a tree is growing under the continuously moist conditions, then there is a fact that it grows very faster. If there are continuously moist conditions, then the tree will grow faster, but at the same time, it will not be the strongest. So that is also a fact associated with the strength of the timber. And we are studying this cross-section and microstructure of wood to understand the strength phenomena of the timber. So now we will discuss about what are the various properties of the timber. So here, if we will start with the term moisture content. Well, this, as I said, when there is a live tree, it is having moisture more than it is around 100 to 300% of the moisture carried by the live tree. And when they are cut, when they fall, this moisture starts drying up. And also there is a very important fact that wood is a hygroscopic material. Now, what is the meaning of hygroscopic? It means that it picks up or gives off moisture to equalize with the relative humidity and temperature in the atmosphere. So whatever is the humidity level in the atmosphere, either it picks up from the atmosphere or it lose or it gives to the atmosphere. So that criteria is to be considered when we design the timber structure. So if higher is the moisture content in the timber, lower will be the strength. So therefore, moisture content should be minimum in the timber to have maximum strength. Now, talking about the strength criteria of the timber, well, this strength of the timber is affected by various properties, and in that, one of the most important property is the density. So strength of the timber is directly proportional to tension, to the density. And if density of the timber is high, if the structure of the timber is highly dense, then the strength will also be very high. And also, the strength of timber is affected by various natural defects also. We will discuss about the defect later, but that is also a point that these defects also affect the strength of the timber. And as I discussed earlier, that timber is highly anisotropic material because of its cellular structure. Therefore, the strength properties of the timber should also be considered while designing the timber structure. So we have to consider how we are applying the load, whether we are applying load along the grains of the timber or across the grains of the timber. So we should know in what direction the timber is strong. And as I said, timber strength is also affected by the moisture content and also the rate of application of the load and the duration of the load. So how we are applying the load on the timber and at what rate we are applying the load to the timber, that also affects the strength of the timber. And also the temperature. Temperature also affects the properties of the timber. So we will discuss about the temperature aspect later. So first we will see with this visual to understand the strength. So here you can see, as I said, that timber is having cells in the form of tubular form. So here you can see these are basically the tubular form of the timber. And this is actually the microscopic view of the timber. So if we consider this, experiment on this bunch to check the strength, so we can if we apply load on this bunch along the length or along the length of the grain, if we consider this as the length of the grain, then we see that it is strong along the length, but it is weak when we apply load perpendicular to the grain. So this visual clearly indicates us that timber is strong along the length of the grain. They are stiff along the length of the grain, and they are weakest when we apply load in this manner. So as I said, moisture content affects the strength of the timber. So here, as a part of comparison, if we consider the strength of timber in the dry state, when it is completely dry, then we can say that the bending strength of the timber is high, as much as 50% higher than the strength in the wet state of the timber. So therefore, it is very important to have dry timber or the moisture content to be at the least as much as possible. So therefore, generally on the timber elements, we conduct various tests to check the strength. Now, to check the strength in various aspects. For example, if we want to check the tensile strength of the timber, we conduct tensile test. If we want to check compressive strength of the timber, we conduct compressive strength test. And also, if we want to check the bending strength of the timber, we conduct bending test. And so there are various types of tests which are being conducted on the timber. And those test results are plotted in the table. And also, so those results are very helpful while we design the timber elements. So for example, if there is a timber element and if a tension test conducted on this timber element, say for example, it is failing at 10 Newton per mm square. So we can say that the tensile strength of the timber is 10 Newton per mm square. So that is the maximum possible strength of this type of timber. to design the element of this to design the element of this type of timber, what we do is we will be taking the fraction of this strength, because we know that this much strength will not be borne by the timber for its whole life. So therefore we reduce this, we take fraction of this strength by multiplying it with the reduction factor. So therefore in the timber design, as I said, allowance is made for the effect of moisture content that would expose to wet condition by multiplying the grade stresses. Now this grade stresses are basically the maximum stresses. So this strength can also be considered as the grade stress. And to have the working stress, what we will be doing is we will take its fractional part. So to get the fraction, we will be multiplying this value with the reduction factor to get the permissible stresses. So in the design, we actually use these permissible stresses, which are having values different for different condition. If we have a timber element which is exposed directly to the atmosphere, then we take different permissible stresses. Similarly, if the timber is located inside the building, so that timber will be having less chances to expose to atmosphere directly. So therefore it will be maintained properly. So therefore its strength can be higher than the timber having the exposed exposure. So we will see these permissible stresses. We generally use standard in India to design a timber element. We use a standard called IS 883. So this is the IS code which we generally use to design the timber element. So first I will be showing you this code, and after that I will be showing you the permissible stress table. So here you can see this is the IS code which we will be using for designing the timber element. So the name of IS code is design of structural timber in the building. So here if we scroll down, then there are various terminology which are generally used in the timber structure design. And similarly, the grouping of the timber. So timber is grouped into three category, group A, B, C. We will discuss about this grouping in the slides later. And then there is this table number one. And this table number one is basically the showing the safe permissible stresses for various species of the timber. So here you can see, this is the species of timber, and these are the botanical name of the tree. And then these are the types of tree available in the India. So like, for example, you can see this is the babul tree, and it is found in UP, and the unit mass or density of this babul is also given. Then we have the modulus of elasticity. Similarly, we have bending and tension strength of the timber along the direction of the grain. And in this, we have inside location, outside location, and wet location. So as I said, if timber is inside, which means it is not directly exposed to atmosphere, then we consider it as inside location. Or if timber is directly exposed to atmosphere, then we consider this as outside location. And the third condition is wet location. If timber is located in a location where there is continuously wet condition, for example, in the northeastern region where there is a continuous rainy season. So that condition will be known as wet location. And you can see here, for inside location, we have maximum strength. For outside, we have less permissible strength. And in wet condition, we have further less. Similarly, we have the shear strength of the timber, all location, horizontal, along the grain. So these are the values which we will be using in our design. Now I will be showing you this table in the compressed version, which means I will be showing you table of trees which are commonly found in India. So now again going to the slide. So So here we have this table. So the same table I have provided here also, but this is showing only some of the important trees. And these important trees have different property. For example, density at 12% moisture. So this 12% moisture is the minimum moisture which generally will have in the tree, in the timber all the time. And this is the density in kg per meter cube. Similarly, this is the modulus of elasticity, bending tension, shear, compression strength parallel to grain, and compression strength perpendicular to the grain. So if we apply compression like this, it will be parallel to grain. If we apply compression force like this, it will be perpendicular to the grain. So there are strength for various trees are provided here, and we will be using this table for designing timber elements like the beams, columns. So we will be using this same table. Now talking about another aspect in the properties of the timber. So as we have discussed about the temperature aspect also, timber is affected by temperature also. Although we know that timber is a good heat insulator, but if it is continuously exposed, to the temperature above 100 degree Fahrenheit, then the properties of the timber is affected. So temperature also affects the strength and other properties of the timber. Age effect. Now, if we are able to keep the wood at the dry condition, which is the most important requirement in the timber. So if we are able to keep our timber dry and free from mechanical and insect damage, it will retain and it will remain nearly unchanged, and it will retain its properties over the time. And also in this scenario, we can even use timber, we can even reuse the timber in this scenario. But if the timber is continuously drying and wetting, and if it is affected by insects also, then in that case, we have to replace the timber. So this age effect of the timber is actually dependent on the fact how good we are keeping our timber dry. If we are able to keep our timber dry, then the strength will be retained in the timber. So we will continue our discussion in the next part. Thank you.